A warm good morning to all of you. Good morning. At the outset, I would like to thank the chairman for giving introducing me to the audience in particular, right? And I would also like to thank the organizer for inviting me and interacting with you. And as already mentioned about the title that I'm going to talk about, the approaches for targeting lymphatic uptake and T glycoprotein efflux modulation to enhance bioavailability of antiretroviral drugs in HIV-1 viral reservoirs. The flow will go about, you know, talking about the epidemiology and the demographic data available and what are the approaches available and with what strategy and the objective we started for developing a combinational product for two antiretroviral drugs and so on. Now, talking about the reports by the WHO and AIDS.gov, there is 38 million worldwide living with HIV/AIDS at the end of 2023. 0.7 million deaths have been reported in 2023 due to HIV. And sub-Saharan African is mainly affected, accounting for nearly 70% of the AIDS population. As of June 2023, 26.1 million assessing antiretroviral therapy globally. And India is third largest HIV epidemic in the world in 2023. And HIV prevalence in India is estimated approximately to 0.3% as such. Around 69,220 new cases have been reported, and currently around 75% of people are taking HIV treatment. A small empirical study was done on a sample size of 100 orphan subjects from Desire Society in Apnagar Ashram, age ranging from 8 years to 24 years. And it was found that they reported side effects with the ADRs and the effectiveness of the antiretroviral drug therapy as such. Current treatments of AIDS involve non-nucleotide reverse transcriptase and the nucleotide reverse transcriptase agents, entry inhibitor, PK boosters, protease inhibitors, integrase inhibitors as such. Globally, HIV drugs market size is valued to $32.8 billion in 2023 in US dollar and is projected to reach $51.1 billion by 2033, growing at a cumulative annual growth rate of 4.7% from 2023 to 2033. The key market players are Johnson & Johnson, BMS, and JSK, and particularly in terms of Indian context, we can say Hetero as well, which are working on antiretroviral drugs agents as such. The rationale of the study was that the combination of antiretroviral drugs, which is being termed as HART, is being administered for therapeutic intervention to the HIV patients, and it has able to reduce mortality, but has not been a complete solution to HIV infections as such. And most of the current therapies have viability issues, either due to the poor solubility primarily, or due to extreme first-pass metabolism, which may also be because of the glycoprotein efflux system. It is an ABC transport. At the moment the drug is coming into the systemic circulation, it is thrown back into the lumen. That is a major problem with P glycoprotein efflux system. Developing a formulation. So I was talking about the challenges which are being faced by the antiretroviral drug therapy, and developing a formulation that can effectively address all the challenges, particularly the bioavailability issue, will be an advancement for antiretroviral therapy as such. We reviewed all combinational approaches which are available, right? And we came up with a systematic review on combinational approaches, particularly in terms of the nanocarrier drug delivery system as such. So for this study, we first of all, you know, selected a NRTI, that is the nucleotide reverse transcriptase inhibitor, and this drug itravirine was basically converted into a nano structured lipid carrier, and then we published a study in Discover Nano, followed by, I think this is not working. Yeah. So the another one was the protease inhibitor, which is also being reported and being delivered to the patients as such. The earlier drug was a BCS class 4 drugs, which was having a low solubility and permeability. This was BCS class 2 drug having solubility issues and lipophilicity, that is log P value of 2.89. It was metabolized primarily by intestinal metabolism and also undergo high first pass metabolism and P glycoprotein efflux system. And this the study in darunavir etranolate was also being published as a single drug nanostructure lipid carrier, and we thought of combining together with a rational as such. Etranavir is an inhibitor of P glycoprotein efflux system that is being reported in the literature, and we thought of combining together with darunavir etranolate, which is a P glycoprotein substrate, and accordingly these were combined together. And the in order to establish the combinational approach, we performed an molecular docking studies where we found that the drug etranavir, which is a reverse transcriptase, also shows HIV protease inhibitory activity, right? So this was an added advantage. But in order to find out the stability with HIV protease, we performed dynamic stimulation studies in order to find out, and the studies revealed that the binding free energy suggested that etranavir makes a more stable complex with reverse transcriptase rather than protease inhibitor. So they were having two different mechanisms to talk together. The rationale for formulation was a nanostructure lipid carrier. In the first stages, in the primitive time, the drug which are oil soluble, they were converted in emulsion formulation with the help of an emulsifier. And then the next stage came, you have the multiple emulsion followed by micro emulsion, nano emulsion, and then solid lipid nanoparticle. Solid lipid nanoparticles were having the carrier as a solid lipid, and since the structural was not irregular, so there was an expulsion of the drug, and the high payload was not attained. There was a physical instability, and that's why in order to come up with an irregularity in the structure, so that there is a high payload of the drug and there is no expulsion, the liquid lipids were also incorporated, and the latest form is a nanostructure lipid carrier, where you have a combination of a solid lipid mixed with a liquid lipid, so that the irregular structures provide a platform where you can have a high drug payload and more long-term stability. Lipid excipient in addition to providing the stability also modulate as a P glycoprotein mediated efflux activity, and they are also being reported with an improved absorption by direct uptake through lymphatic route, inducing bilary secretion and promoting formation of micellar solubilization as such. This is the research review where we just combined together two different drugs with two different type of activities, and NLC was formulated through oral route in order to treat HIV infections. So the objective was combining together etranavir and darunavir in combination with a P glycoprotein inhibitor, TPGS, right? This is a derivative of vitamin E, which also act as a solubilizer and a stabilizer as well, right? And then trying to find out the efficacy by the in vitro cell line studies and such. These are routine pre-formulation studies were carried out in order to record various physicochemical characteristics, which will help in coming up with the in vitro characterization and so on. A drug-drug compatibility study was also performed in order to establish that there is no drug-drug interaction in particular for both the drugs. And in vitro cytotoxicity studies were performed for pure drug and the combination on TZM, a B1 cell line. We had a collaboration with Nano 8 Drug Research Institute, and accordingly, it was found, they reported that a combination of 1:6.5 microgram per ml is giving a good anti-HIV activity in particular. Antiretroviral activities were pure, and the combination products were also investigated on two different HIV strains, Indian strain and Ugandan strain. And it was found that in the Indian strain had better activity against these combinational products and demonstrated potent activity at lower concentration compared to other ratios of etranavir and darunavir as such. And after this establishment, we just screened various liquid lipids in order to find out the solubility so that the dose go into the liquid lipid in particular. And it was found that the longer triglyceride shows more solubility than the medium chain, which leads to the higher entrapment efficiency. After that, we also tried to find out which solid lipid is going to give a higher solubility, where the drug dose can also be incorporated. And accordingly, a combination of a liquid lipid and a solid lipid was selected. And a series of surfactants were screened in order to find out a more stable formulation. So Solutol HS15 was selected as an emulsifier for the fabrication of NLC using perisorol and labrafil as a solid and the liquid phases as such. And drug excipient interaction studies after finalizing the solid lipid and liquid lipid were also done in order to find out there is no degradation on keeping for a specified period of time at 40 and plus minus 75% humidity as such. Drug excipient interaction studies were also established by DSC thermogram and FTIR, and it was found that there is no interaction particularly with this. And we just tried to find out what is the binary mixture of soil lipid and liquid lipid to be taken in combination with the solid lipid and the lipid lipid. And that was also done through finding out the crystallinity index by DSC studies in order to find out the combination to be used. And it was found that on the basis of the crystallinity index, a 50% solid lipid and a 50% liquid lipid is going to give a more compatible system as such. The formulation development was based on a design of an experiment, which was based on the CCRD, and we just tried to find out the QTTPs and the CQAs and the process parameter. The principal notion behind redefining QTTPs was to have a patient-driven the etranavir and adenovir NLC formulation, wherein maximum therapeutic advantage could be derived from the system. It is accomplished by judiciously determining the CQAs like globule size, percentage entrapment efficiency, and polydispersity index, and then determining the CQAs. Therefore, the attribute, that is particle size and entrapment efficiency in PDI, were selected, which offer their advantages toward nano system development and which also indicate a more stable system in particular as such. The formulation development, the independent variable taken was the solid total lipids and the emulsifier and the sonication time from 60 to 180 second based on the literature as such. And the dependent variable, as mentioned already, it is a particle size and entrapment efficiency and PDI as such, right? And the formulation was based on a modified emulsion sonication method as such. The various runs were done, right, for the CCRD using 0.75% TPGS, which was earlier optimized, and accordingly, with the increase in the lipid concentration, there was an increase in the particle size, and more amount of the surfactant is required to emulsify the lipid in the aqueous phase in particular. And this lack of surfactant leads to the agglomeration of particles, causing an increase in the particle size. However, it has been noted that the increase in lipid matrix increases the entrapment efficiency and the drug loading. But it was more important to optimize the lipid concentration, right? And then accordingly, surfactant concentration and the sonication time was optimized, where the binary mixture 50:50 surfactant and sonication time was optimized through the CCRD, and the optimum globule size which was obtained was less than 200 nanometer with the PDI and the zeta potential value and a high entrapment efficiency and a loading drug loading capacity. The characterization of optimized formulation revealed an average particle zeta size of 169.3, and then a surface morphology for TEM was also performed in order to understand the surface topography of the drug and lyophilized dalanovir and etranavir nanostructural lipid carrier as such. These were also optimization and the characterization were also done in order to find out the interaction after whether any manufacturing process has brought into any interaction in the drug and the excipients through the DSC and the FTIRs. In order to study the crystallinity nature of the NLC formed, it was found both the drugs are crystalline in nature and the NLC formulation shows less intense peak, talking about partial amorphization or entrapment of both the drug into the NLC formulation as such. In vitro release studies were performed in order to depict the whole of the physiological pH condition of for gastric region and a fat state, small intestine, and the simulated intestinal fluid in order to find out the cumulative percentage release, right? And an F2 value represented that there was entirely a different release pattern for both NLC formulation and drug suspension, which was not similar in terms as such. In vitro lipolysis studies were done in order to find out how the NLC formulation is going to behave in the body, human body, and we were subjected to a digestive media in order to record the amount of drug in the lipid phase and in the aqueous phase, and it was found that the drug on lipolysis, the aqueous phase has more quantity of dalanovir and the etranavir drugs concentration is. In vitro hemolysis studies were done in order to find out the compatibility in when it is being administered, and there was no any toxic type of more safe formulation was reported. Since the drug was undergoing AP glycoprotein efflux, so in combination to the intestinal permeation, both in the everted and the non-everted sac method, efflux ratio was also calculated, both in the presence of etranavir, which has been reported to be a P glycoprotein inhibitor, and within TPGS also, which has also been reported to be a P glycoprotein inhibitor as such. The ED NLC formulation showed a reduction of efflux ratio, because the efflux ratio, which is higher than 2, it shows a P glycoprotein efflux as such, and accordingly that was drastically reduced by terms of NLC formulation as such. Confocal microscopy talked about the, it revealed that there is a higher intestinal permeation when the formulation was given by TPGS as compared to the non-TPGS formulation as such. The, after this formulation, the cytotoxicity of HIV infection by the NLC formulation was also again conducted after the optimization of the formulation. And it was found that the enhanced antiretroviral efficacy of an NLC formulation, particularly the combination, has significantly lower concentration, presenting a promising avenue for developing more potent and efficient anti-HIV therapeutics as such. And subsequently, the NLC formulation of the drug combination, etranavir-denovir, exhibited over 50% inhibition on HIV infection, with a minimum drug administration concentration approximately 58 times lower than that required for the pure drug concentration. So there was a drastic decrease in the lower dosing, and this drug lowering is also indicative of less side effects accordingly, and more patient compliance in particular. This was also, the PK studies was also performed by establishing a biological method. It was developed and it was validated particularly, and then these pharmacokinetic studies were done, and it shows that etranavir and denovir from the NLC formulation exhibited a 3.7-fold and 2.9-fold enhancement in viability compared to the simple drug per se mixed together. Histopathological examination was done in liver, spleen, and brain, that there is no cytotoxicity, any toxic or any changes in the morphology in the tissue structure is being reported. So it was found that they were safe in histopathological studies as well. Stability studies were performed, that is the physical stability, and for the storage condition of 6 months, and the physical parameters like particle size, sedimentation, phase separation, and PDI was reported for both the formulations as such. And a shelf life was also calculated in terms of the having a shelf life of almost like 8 months, reported at room temperature for 25 degrees Celsius. The 10 images for freshly prepared, that is a 0-day formulation, and the formulation on complete, they do not show any significant changes in the particle size at the term studies as such. Now here is the overview which talks about the outcome of the research work, and as mentioned already, the cell line studies, they potentiated that the combination of the etranavir and the denovir when using nanocarrier formulation is used at a lower much dose as compared to the conventional formulation, that may lead to a potential advantage of administering them together. The publication was combined together, and it was also published as a research outcome. So summarizing and concluding, the etranavir and the denovir TPGS NLC were optimized, and they were fabricated by modified emulsion sonication process, wherein TPGS acts as a PGP modulator and a stabilizer as well, using CCRD. Significantly improved permeation of etranavir and denovir across all the gut membrane for etranavir and TPGS NLC approximately more than 4-fold and 3-fold respectively. Higher permeation than the etranavir and the denovir suspension, which was aligned with the result of confocal microscopy examination. In the pharmacokinetic study, etranavir and denovir TPGS NLC improved the bioavailability of etranavir and denovir compared to the suspension, The pharmacokinetic parameter coincided with the gut instantaneous permeation and confocal depth studies. Due to the improved viability of etanavir and denavir, the optimized formulation can reduce the dose and accordingly minimize the peripheral side effects associated with the dose-related burdens. The finding position the NLC formulation of ED as a promising candidate for advanced anti-HIV therapeutic development. Further studies and clinical trials will be crucial to validate these encouraging results and facilitate the progression of this formulation towards clinical applications as such. This is the group which is involved in some of the projects on antiretroviral drug. The work is being funded by ICMR and DST as well. And these are the references. And thank you for patient listening.